My name is Steve Horton and this is a Basingstoke Makerspace presentation. This video is about a web-based game called Metazooa, which gives you a new game every day like Wordle and Where Taken. But this one is based on biological classifications. I think it's well worth having a go at. You can find it at the address shown here. The game randomly selects an animal and the player has to guess what it is. As you type in your guesses, the game lists the 10 closest animals and you pick the value that you want to try. The game then gives you the first grouping that contains both your animal and the target. In this case, bilatera. That is, animals that are symmetric. The fact it did not give us, for example, chordate, means that the animal does not have a spine like a mink. So, let's try cuttlefish. The fact that the game has now given us coelidia tells us that this is a different soft-bodied animal. So let's try an octopus. And we have solved the game. The branches here are based on the standard biological classifications. The game uses data from the National Centre for Biological Information. The NCBI is a fantastic source of freely available biology data. Now, we all remember how to classify animals, right? We have 7 different levels. For humans, as an example, the species is human, the genus is Homo, the family is Hominidae, the order is primates, the class is mammal, the phylum is animals with backbones, and the kingdom is multicellular animals. Chimpanzees and bonobos share a genus of Pan, and Pan and Homo are sister genuses in the Hominidae family. And of course, this type of tree branching goes all the way up the tree of life. All multicellular animals are in the Metazooa kingdom, so everything is easy to understand. Except that, if we focus on the family, we have extra levels. We have subfamilies and superfamilies. Indeed, if we look at the NCBI data about humans, we don't have 7 levels, we have 28. The NCBI data is big. It lists more than 2 million species. So, the first thing we will need to do is to reduce our data down a little bit. If we restrict ourselves to just species that have common names, we only have 33,000 species to deal with. When playing the game, it suggests species to us. If we type the letter D, we get 10 suggestions that start with a D, or have a D in them. Indeed, the game is cleverer than that. If we type DOG, the game suggests the closest allowed option, which in this case is wolf. Here are the 255 animals that the game uses at the moment. Let's consider one of these at random. Dove, for example. Wikipedia says that the term dove is actually very loosely defined. There are more than 300 species that could all be referred to using that term. But we can see exactly which of these the game uses by using it in practice mode. Type in dove and click on the dove box in the diagram. And it shows that the developer selected white-tipped dove. Not the one I would have picked as a typical dove, but we can use it. Once we've worked out how all 255 Metazooa names relate to the common names that NCBI defines, we can extract the complete hierarchy for each of those species. However, there's another thing we have to do. In this data, a lot of the intermediate nodes have just single items below them. Here, for example, are the apes. You can see the genus Homo here is actually of no use in the game. We need to tidy up all the raw NCBI data by removing these redundant nodes. Selecting the NCBI data related to the 255 Metazooa species, then removing nodes that just have a single child gives us a list of 437 nodes. Here is what the top part of that tree looks like. The biggest classes are the mammals, the birds, the insects, the bony fish, and the reptiles. Here is the start of the whole list in text form. The complete list is in this document and can be downloaded from this location. If we know all these groupings, how does that help us to play the game? Let's look again at the tree of apes. If we are playing with just these nodes, we could perhaps guess that the species is human. There are only 5 ways the game could respond. It could tell us we've guessed the correct answer, or it could show us the homininae subfamily, which means the answer can only be gorilla, chimpanzee, or bonobo. Or it could give us the family level, in which case the answer must be orangutan. Or the superfamily, in which case gibbon must be the correct answer. Or the path order, which tells us the answer is one of the 3 unnamed species over on the left. Each of these 5 responses gives us a certain amount of information. Claude Shannon explained how this works 75 years ago. If we get the first response, our guess has reduced the number of possibilities from 9 to 1. That ratio gives us 3.17 bits of information. In contrast, if the response was the subfamily, there are 3 possibilities left. So, the number has gone from 9 to 3. In other words, it's reduced by a factor of 3, which is 1.58 bits of information. The other 3 possible responses have similar calculations. In order to know the average amount of information, we have to multiply each information value by the probability of getting it. 1 in 9 for the first reply, 3 in 9 for the second, and so on. Adding all these contributions together tells us that selecting human will, on average, give us 2.11 bits of information. If, on the other hand, our guess had been orangutan, then the average information delivered would be 1.75 bits. Each guess we could have made has its own average information delivered. Hence, in this situation, the guess that gives us the most information would be either chimpanzee or bonobo. That same calculation, using the complete tree, gives these values for the average information. The worst first choice would be jellyfish. The best choice for first guess would be mink, weasel, or one of the 2 types of otter. Once we've made that first guess, then either we've found the animal, or, more likely, the tree of possible choices has been reduced by the response the game gave. This new tree can be used to do the whole calculation again to work out the best choice for our second guess. This way we can play out the whole game for every possible target animal. Here is the listing of all those 255 games played out in full. Again, this is in the downloadable document. On average, these games require 4.23 guesses. The longest game is 12 guesses and ends up at Flamingo. If, rather than calculating the average information, we go down each of the branches that has the largest number of leaf species, would that have a different effect on the longest game? Well, the average game length is bigger and the longest game is just as long. There seems little point. The longest game here ends up at Toucan, right next to Flamingo. What is it about the birds? Here is the tree below the Avis class, that is, all the birds. Look at this node. It has 11 nodes below it. So of course the longest game has to be 12 guesses. One to get to this node, and then one each for all the descendants. If we pick a bird first, then we can reduce the longest game by one move. So let's pick a bird first. Well, This does reduce the longest game to 11 guesses, but it increases the average game length. Is it worth it? Calculating the average information returned for each guess on every reachable tree is hard, but as this plot shows, it has a strong correlation with the depth the species node is down the tree. What if we use this instead? If we use this depth metric for the initial guess, the average game is 4.48. However, using an initial guess of mink followed by guesses based on depth, the average game is only very slightly more than it was for the fully calculated tree. This time saving seems to justify the shortcut. So here's the takeaway. First, you should select weasel, mink, or one of the otters. If you want to reduce the maximum number of guesses, you should pick a bird. Second, if at any point the best node you have is Neognathi, then hit the hint button. It'll save you time in the long run. Thirdly, always try and select a valid guess that is as deep down the tree as possible. And finally, biological classification is complicated. Thanks to Trainwreck Labs Limited for creating this and other great games, and thanks to you for listening to this whole thing. Finally, download the document from this location and have fun with it.